Our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. I hope and pray that we will be blessed by the end of the Sabbath as we spend time in the throne of grace and mercy. One of the passions that I have also is to take out health to this world. It's an entering which, according to the pen of inspiration, that will open inroads to reach to people. And I want to give all of you an opportunity to. I'm sniffing and God of your love because I didn't finish my course of antibiotics. I'm not talking about the antibiotic that the GP will prescribe me. I'm talking about an actual antibiotic. It's antibiotic, it's antiviral, it's anti-everything. Sometimes it's anti-human beings as well. It gets smell in your mouth. I'll give you the recipe. Those who want to write it down, you can write it down. Take your pens if you like. I'll give you a recipe. This is a natural prescription from God's pharmacy. This is God's pharmacy. Natural prescription. One whole bulb of garlic. Of course, you peel the peeling out of it. Four whole onions. Of course, you take the peeling out of the onions. Two red, two white. Be very specific. Four onions, two red onions, two white onions. And then four whole lime or lemon. You can choose whichever is available. And lime and lemon, skin included. Okay? Onions and garlic, skin excluded. Lime or lemon, skin included. And then 1.5 inch of ginger root. You can choose to leave the skin off if you wash it very well and take the mud and everything else off. 1.5 inch of turmeric root. Look at the ingredients. 6 to 8 tablespoons of honey. Now each of this will work on its own. But when you put them together, there's nothing then that can withstand the potent attack of this antibiotic or antiviral that has plagued your body. Chop all of this into pieces. All of this bulk of garlic, onion, ginger, lemon, turmeric, and blend them. Don't add water. Honey is your liquefier. And 1 tablespoon 3 times a day. You can take any time, before food, with food, after food, doesn't matter. It works miracles. My wife was plagued with this flu virus or cold or whatever. She had back pain, all body pain, fever, everything. She took this for a day, next day she's up and out. It's a course for 7 days, like antibiotic treatment. You can take it for prophylaxis, you can take it for treatment, whichever you like. We'll now sing our theme song, Isaiah 43, 10 and 11. And I'll request my teammates to come to sing in this song. Those who were with me last night, because I'm not a singer myself, I'll go off. My teammates, please quickly, whoever wants to join me, can join me. Isaiah 43. We all know this by heart, if you memorize it. These verses, it's a powerful doctrine. Powerful doctrine, those of you who were here last night, we have sang a couple of times. So everybody sing loud, those who already sang it a few times. Okay, we'll sing this song, Isaiah 43, 10 and 11. For those who are here only this morning, we're going to sing verse 10 to the end, then we continue verse 11 to the end, and we go back to the middle of verse 10 and pick up from, what did I say? And understand that I am He, and we finish at verse 10. That's how the verse goes. We'll sing it a couple of times. So that you get it.
We are witnesses, said the Lord.
That's all during the break time. during the break time. Life in the 1940s. I want you to listen to this carefully. Life in the 1940s, it looked like this. If you're born before 1945, consider the changes that have been taken place. You were born before TV, penicillin, polio shots, Xerox machines. There were no frozen foods or contact lenses, no frisbees, no birth control pills, no radar, no credit cards, split tablets, laser beams, or ballpoint pens. Come along with dishwashers, clothes dryers, but yet to come. No electric blankets, air conditioning, before man could even walk on the moon. In those days, closets were clothes kept, not where people came out of. Bunnies were rabbits, and rabbits were not Volkswagens. They lived in before gay rights, computer dating, house husbands. Sorry, I'm pausing. When I pause, it means you have to understand. Dual careers, drive-through managers, it was before group therapies, daycare centers, nursing and old age homes. They were never heard of FM radio, CD, DVD, Blu-ray, whatever you call it, electronic typewriters, word processors, artificial hearts, guys wearing earrings. Women's bodies were covered neck to toe. And of course, you need to think. Trousers were waist high and not falling off the backside. Time sharing meant togetherness and not condominiums. There were no laptop computers. PS4, 5, whatever you call them, is the school you attended. And V is what you said when you push a child on its way. A Bluetooth was what you get when you eat an Italian icy. And cell phones were only found on the wall of a prison cell. A chip was a piece of wood, hardware, software wasn't even a word. Not possible back then to upgrade your memory. In the 1940s, made in Japan meant junk. Making out men how you did in your exam. Pizza, McDonald's, Burger King, KFC, instant coffee, and the list goes on, were unheard of. Spikes were found in the ground and not in someone's head. Back then you could buy things for 5 cents. One nickel could take you on a city bus ride, make a phone call, or buy food. You could buy a Chevy for $600, but who could afford it anyway? And gas was 11 cents a gallon. In those days, grass was mowed and not smoked. Thought was something you cooked in. Rock music was grandma's lullaby. Hip-hop was a game you played and not something you listened to. In those days, aides were helpers in the principal's office. Back then, there was no difference between sexes. Men were men and women were women. And were happy to be that. There was no such thing as sex change operation. They were satisfied with the way God created them. Back then, man and woman got married and then lived together. This is the last generation so dumb to know that you need to have a husband first to have a baby. Times have really changed, haven't they? We have become gadgetarians and not people of the book. Today, I recommend to you something. Everybody look at me. At least now. No, don't look at me when I say look at you. I'm not the most best personality here. Look at me. Look at what I'm doing. I recommend to you the book. And I recommend to you Facebook. I recommend to you Facebook. I'll say it a third time. I recommend to you Facebook. Not what's on your gadgets. A lot of time people are wasting on Facebook. And we don't have time to face the book, the word of life. And that's why we are what we are today. We heard about it last night, Laodiceans. We are Laodiceans. And God said what he said here was pretty long. What a blessing. Privilege is coming for all of us, and we are not really looking to see where we are in time. We are not looking to see where we are as human beings, as believers and sons and daughters. We claim this message. 1 Peter 2:9. We are a chosen generation. Look at the synonyms that are used there. Chosen generation, royal priesthood, holy nation. Peculiar people, are we? Are we? I ask the question. Two people were on the other side of the riverbank. A group of people are discussing to identify who those people are. And they looked closely and said, they are Jehovah's Witnesses. Somebody said. Another person said, no. They are Mormons. How could they tell? How could they tell? By how they dress? Today, in church, we have fashion parades. Everybody goes, sorry, ladies, I have to be fine, because this is what the truth is. Go in front of the mirror. You want to see how best you are presenting yourself? I recommend to you, when you go in front of the mirror, ask the question to yourself, is my dress, my appearance representing Jesus Christ? I recommend to you that today. If not, change your appearance, change your dress. Because we sang the song, "We Are My Witnesses." And the servant whom I have chosen, God is telling about you and me. You can't be a servant and misrepresent him. We're going to learn more. I'm highlighting you this because the day is coming. I'm calling my wife. We'll sing a song which all of us, everybody knows, and he's probably sang a few times in your church, but the Lord impressed me that we need to sing this song to remind ourselves. I'm not a singer, my wife is. You are company. If I go off, by the grace of God, I won't. You will be fine. Please come. Let's learn, let's understand these words as we have heard them over and again. All what you're hearing today, you already heard them again. These are reminders for us to wake up. I'm not saying I didn't pray. My parents taught me to pray. And we still practice this in our houses. Then I raise from my bed, I pray, I do my study. Then as a family, we come together and have worship. And throughout the day, we tend to learn some Bible passages. And in the night, again, we have family worship. And then we have our own personal study and prayer. All this happens. Typical Adventist, vicious lifestyle. But never a real connection with God. I went on my knees for 3 months, saying, Lord, what is this? And the Lord said, I want you to do my work. I started printing literature in 2000. I took up a job in 2001, Global Medical Center. Till today, you can go and speak to anybody who was there when I was there. By the grace of God, if I go there, people, I'm telling you to grace with honor and glory of God, they say you, literally say you. The watchman there, he will save you. Not because I'm big shot in the hospital, because I worked as a servant of God in the hospital. The first time I stood up to speak a sermon was in Elizabeth Church on a Friday evening, and by the grace of God I had a translator, so I survived to read lines in between while the translation is going on, and that's how the Lord prepared me. First time I ever stood up to speak without a translation was in Surat Hospital Church, 2004. I remember that year. Veer Raju, my classmate, was the pastor there. Jeremiah was there, who was the first principal in Elizabeth School. I worked with him by the grace of God. I worked like a donkey at Elizabeth School, became high school. A part of the work was my hard work. I can claim it. I stood up to speak, and I did not realize 1 hour passed by, because it had nothing to do with me. I had nothing to say, because I was asked to speak Saturday morning, and I'm not a preacher. I didn't even know how to comment in a lesson study. I said, Lord, you have to speak. I don't know what to do. Even saw that evidence last night. My presentation was completely different to what God spoke last night. A few years back, to make my testimony short, after coming to this country, in fact, I prayed. My wife knows this now, but she didn't know it before. We took visa to USA and we didn't go in 1990. We took visa in 2000 to Canada and didn't go. In 2004, I prayed prayer. By now, I started the Reformation in my life. In 2000. So 2004, I prayed, Lord, if you want me to do your work in the UK, give us the visa, otherwise don't give us the visa. That's my prayer. I came here and I forgot my prayer. You understand what I'm saying? Until 4 years ago, 2008, not 4 years, 4 years afterwards, 2008, the Lord had to give me a, you understand? I'm real with my God. Like how I'm real with you. I got double slapped. My mother died of cancer. The same year my wife was diagnosed with cancer. She's sitting here, alive. I said, Lord, what is this? And he reminded me, you know what he prayed? He brought to memory my prayer. So what are you doing? Nothing. Then I began to study again and pray, and the Lord made me come up with this. I think I gave this few years when I came around. This is an outreach to 50,000 gone, and we're going to put another 50,000. We give out to people, we go door to door. We started going door to door in Harlow. We thought more than 10,000 houses. knocking and trying to talk or passing this on if for those who want to have it. This year, 2017, again, last year I prayed on my knees again. I said, Lord, I don't know what to do. I have no talent. My only talent is playing games. That's what I know. I said, Lord, I want to serve you. Use me. That's all I prayed. And now he started opening doors. For the last 4 years, since the time I've recommitted my life to serve him, and reformation process is continuing in my life, the Lord has opened doors. And one dream which I thought I will never fulfill in my life, it was a childhood dream and desire, was to travel the world. That was my desire. After my reformation, listen carefully, after my reformation, my wife counted the number of countries I've been to, 30 countries. In every country, the word of the Lord has been spread. My childhood desire fulfilled after I committed my ways to the Lord. I recommend this to you. Today, unless I have to do a series in terms of presentation by the grace of God, I just go and stand. And now God to speak. It's frightening in the beginning. It's frightening even now. What am I going to stand? I have nothing to say. But when I stand up, God takes control. If He does it for a dumb person like me, who has nothing to say, who has no understanding of anything, a lot of people here seated are better than me. They are not using the potential by surrendering it to the Lord. Let us pray. Mighty God, Heavenly Father, I pause again at your throne of grace, seeking your favor. I ask you, Lord, that you cleanse me of all my sins, sins of commission, sins of omission. Close all my thoughts, O Lord, that you will open your words through my mouth, that would lead me, teach me, and all of us that are seated here. I pray to you, O Lord, that you will keep Satan and his angels out of this place, that you, your Holy Spirit and your holy angels will be present here, teaching us and leading us into all understanding. O Lord, we ask you that you would humble me, O Lord, that you would keep me steadfast and firm as I stand up. You would be with my words and my throat and my tongue and my lips, that you would speak. And help us, O Lord, as in the provocation, that we hear your voice today. We would not harden our hearts, but we would hearken to your voice. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. This year, by the grace of God, I come up with the Lord's inspiration. It's another book, and it's called A Handbook for Evangelism. Everything that this 21st generation out there with throat questions at, by the grace of God, they're compiled and put together in one place. It's a good tool to have with you, rather than telling somebody, you have your manual, and you have your tool. Second tool, you have the Spirit of Prophecy as your primary enlightenment. And a tool here giving you most of the questions of today. It's got history of the Sabbath timeline from creation till today. It's got history of the genealogy of the Bible and how its events took place throughout the genealogy in the Bible itself. It has the history of the world, the Christian history included. It's got so many timelines, it's got even the chart and its explanation in here that we looked in the morning during Sabbath school. It's got about Jesus and his role to us today, relevance and everything else. He talks about how to reach out to Catholics, how to reach out to other Christians, how to reach out to Hindus, how to reach out to Muslims, how to reach out to various groups of people that you have in the world today. It's a powerful tool. I don't have too many to give every single person, but you're in the presence of the Lord. If you're already, mark my words please, if you're already talking to people out there, and you want a book, I'll give you one. Don't tell me, give me the book, I will talk. No, please, don't do that to me. I'm very straight. I don't worry about offending people. Truth is truth, and it remains true. So if you are such a person, you can meet me after church, I will give you the book. If you're already talking to people, if you want more tools, see me and I'll give it to you. Let's look at the secret of life. This is the secret of life. And today's presentation should stir us up. Last night we talked, we are in the times of shaking. Even in the morning, we are living in the period of shaking times. And we have a serious situation in the Laodicean church. The secret of life. Revelation 12:12 says, "Woe to the inhabitants of the earth and of the sea, for the devil is come down unto you, having great wrath, because he knoweth that he hath but a short time. Be sober, be vigilant, because your adversary the devil, as a roaring lion, walketh about seeking whom he may devour." 1 Peter 5:8. Keeping this in mind, we're going to go through a series of events or series of things that the Bible talks about and that we need to learn and understand. We'll begin with music. This is the first tool the devil is using in this 21st generation. You understand? You know who Satan was in heaven? Sorry, not to find you, but he could sing in 8 parts at one time. If you play a certain kind of music, you find a certain kind of crystal. This is the formation of water into crystal forms. Depending on the music that is played near the water, crystal formation takes place. You can read for yourself. I'm not going into details for want of time. Classic music by the likes of Mozart or Bach and Beethoven produces exquisite crystals. When an amazing grace is played, that's the crystal comes up. If you play Mozart symphony, that's how it looks. If you play heavy metal music, that's the crystal you get. If you play Heartbreak Hotel by Elvis Presley, you know that song? That's the crystal form. Literally break. Do you know the effect of music? We think, no, it's not just music. That's what the devil wants you to know. Let me zoom it a little bit down. An experiment was done by a lady. Mrs. Rotlack ran a series of trials with sweet corn, squash, petunia, zinnias, and marigolds. Look at this. Under controlled experiments, playing of rock music caused some of the plants at first to grow either abnormally tall and put out excessively small leaves or remain stunted. Within a fortnight, all the marigolds had died, but 6 feet away, identical marigolds enjoying the classical strains of Haydn, Beethoven, Brahms, and Schubert were flowering. More interestingly, Mrs. Rathak found out that even during the first week, the rock music stimulated plants were using much more water than classically entertained vegetation. Despite this examination of the roots of the 18-day, revealed that soil growth was sparse in the well-watered group, averaging only about an inch, whereas in the second, it was thick, tangled, and about 4 times as long. Further experiments in which Mrs. Rathak submitted her plants to acid rock music revealed that all the plants leaned away from the cacophony. When she rotated all the pots 180 degrees, the plants lean decidedly in the opposite direction. We're talking about plants. Let's look at human beings. Christian Rock is the daughter of early rock. We have the Holland and we have the daughters, remember? Heavy metal rock, rap, graffiti, breakdancing, bodybuilding, brick smashing. Sorry, some words I can't even say. And all this stand-up comedy of all have been added to the evangelical repertoire. It is nothing but hedonism under the guise of religion. It's already there out in the Christian world and it's coming into Adventism. Today we have people standing in the front between Sunday school and Divine Service called a praise team. I don't know whom they're praising. Praise team? Music in the Bible is used primarily in praise and worship, either to God, if you read this text, we're not going there for want of time, or to Satan, if you read those texts. Does music affect man's physical body? Let's look at this. Investigation has shown that music affects digestion, internal secretions, circulation, nutrition, and respiration. Anybody has these problems? Example what music you're listening to. Blood pressure is lowered by sustained chords and raised by crisp, repeated ones. Rock rhythms cause the heartbeat to lose its perfect rhythm. Dr. John Diamond, a medical doctor who conducted extensive research on the medical effects of music, he has noted that man is rhythmic in respiration, heartbeat, pulse, speech and gait. And when classical music is played, it produces feelings of ecstasy, alertness and peace. And it energizes the mind and body and facilitates balance and self-control. As the stock energetic rhythm of rock music heightens stress and anger, reduces output, increases hyperactivity, and weakens strength of the muscles. The tragic truth is that most Christians judge effectiveness of music based on the yardstick of the flesh, rather than the yardstick of the spirit. If a song thrills, we like it. If it doesn't excite us, we don't like it. Too often our opinion of a song is not based on musical, textual, or even biblical worth of it, but rather on how it makes us feel. As in so many other areas of life, we take the sensual approach to music. We talk about physical body. You know what it does to the brain? The power of music to affect memory is quite intriguing. Mozart's music and Baroque music with a 60 beats per minute beat pattern activate the left and the right brain. The simultaneous left and right brain action maximizes learning and retention of information. The information being studied activates the left brain while the music activates the right brain. Also, activities which engage both sides of the brain at the same time, such as playing an instrument or singing, causes the brain to be more capable of processing information. Music directly affects the chemicals called neurotransmitters which relay information in our head. Drugs work in a similar way, except they make your brain lazy and convince it to stop making its own chemicals. Do you have an example of this in the Bible? Do we have an example of this in the Bible? Come on, Bible students, people of the book. No? Nothing comes to your mind? David and King Saul, remember? Let's move on. I won't read all of this. In Vancouver, Beatles, 30 minutes Beatles performance, 100 people were stomped on, gouged and assaulted. Whenever these rock shows happen, there's always something happening there. You know why? The effects of music, the power of volume. All this is horrible. For want of time, I'm not going to go through them because power of volume can even cause ulcers. Music is the highway to hell. The wrong type of music, obviously, is the highway to hell. Everybody heard of the Dravidian branch, Dravidian incident that took place a few years ago, 1993. What happened there? He used to play rock music to keep them under control. Then he killed everybody. These heaven controlled men and women, all the people out there today who are in the music industry, are controlled by them. They sold their lives to them. We'll look at a few examples. It says that the more they flaunt their demonology, the more they will be empowered by the devil to continue doing so. Yet it is all a deception. Satan is not nice to anyone, even those who are on his side working for him. He will kill them. Master Satan is Aleister Crowley. You know who he is? He's the one who started the Church of Satan. Do you know that there are people who are worshiping Satan today? Openly. Help teach Anthony LaVey, who started the Satanic Church of America with headquarters in San Francisco. You know what San Francisco history is? The Bible tells us to watch and pray. We don't watch. We watch all the wrong things on television, all the movies and all the serials and everything else, because we're not watching the times that we're living in to be prepared and warned. Before his death, Crowley made human sacrifices in his house. The house is now owned by Zed Epi, guitarist, and Jimmy Page. Look at all your artists here. I mean, let me show you some more things. Look at all these people, and this is the music we will listen today. 6 days shall the labor and do all their work, including music. And Sabbath, when you come to church, you want to sing hymns. Oh, that's so boring. Let's sing charismatic songs, praise and worship. You know, hymns have doctrines. Christian contemporary music, they have themes. Themes are not what we prepare you for heaven. Doctrines is what will prepare you to heaven. Some of the songs we sing, I stop, I don't sing them anymore in the hymns. Some of the verses, I'm afraid. There's a doctrine there. We sing, my lips, we serve him, he says. That's exactly what we do. We sing the song with no meaning at all. We just sing the song. I stop, I can't sing it anymore. It pierces my heart. Look at this artist. Satan killed him for trying to expose him. Few people are listed. Michael Jackson. These are all the artists we have today. They are straight from the devil. These two people were killed by their own friend. Because human sacrifice is required in Satanism. Everybody knows him? There's a history about him. I put only his example because everybody knows it. Michael Jackson is breakdance, walk on the moon or whatever they call it. People tend to do that. All the kids want to do that. You have to keep the Satan back, not Michael Jackson's. You know he was killed by Satan because he wanted to expose Satan in this album. This album is exposing the Illuminati and its work. When he understood the truth, he wanted to expose Illuminati and what they are doing. And because of that, he was killed. Anybody heard of this voodoo? Heard of voodoo? This is the root of all music. You know what it is? It's an ancient African music. They dance like serpents, going in circles, invoking the evil spirits. That is the root of music. And you know how it moved from there? Africans were taken slaves. They passed through a route. They passed through Haiti. From Africa to Haiti. We had an earthquake in Haiti. From Haiti to San Francisco. Today, if you see in the news, what happens in San Francisco? It's the center of LGBT. Can you see where the devil is leading people through satanic music? New Orleans, we move on because the clock is ticking in. I think I'll take 2 hours of the space I'm going. But thou, O Daniel, shut up the words and seal the book, even to the time of the end, men shall run to and fro, and knowledge shall increase. Let's look at some gadgets that we have today. Apple has come up with a smartphone which has a microchip implanted in the webbing of it between your thumb and your forefinger. And now you can sit down. They want to make you sick by sitting down. Couch forever. You sit on your couch, you can decide and do whatever you want. So you want the light on? Light is on. You want the door closed? Door is closed. You want the TV on? TV is on. The global elite people already have it. The rich people already have it. They're making this digital face recognition machines. So you go there, you pay with your eyes. They're planning with tags on your bins. These are not simply tags. Apple presents the mark of the beast app. It's the entire phone. So I don't buy Apple. Anything to do with Apple. I'm smart. I use smartphones. Smart television, smart screens. You know what it is? An implanted bug in the home. I have it. But praise the Lord. We talk about God. That's not a religion. They can hear it. I don't mind. They hear the three angels' message. They hear about everything else. Praise the Lord. These smart televisions are implanted. They're bugs like a microphone. They're transponders. Whatever you speak, somebody's watching, somebody's listening. It doesn't have to be on. And even when it's on, chip, very chip. It's coming up across universities now. They're starting with the educational societies and they're coming moving forward. It's mandatory to wear it in some universities. You can't refuse to wear it. You can't. You're part of the university, you wear it. Otherwise, you're not in the university. Even London is coming up with this. Obama wants, I'm ready to bypass Congress with executive orders. I want you to look at some of these executive orders. Somebody put this picture, I liked it, so I took it. Are there similarities? Very much so. Here it says, what the Fourth Amendment police across the US are using radars to see inside people's homes. Video of the day, watch an 8 police officers fire 48 shots and kill a homeless man in broad daylight. We can hear all of these whenever you look at these orders. Executive order number, this exists, this is not a joke. Only when it is implemented, we will see it. Like what Trump said, wait and see. That's the number. Allows the government to take over all modes of transportation and control highways and seaports. There's an order. to do that. They can do it whenever they want. These are existing. Nobody can question them because these orders have been written and kept, ready to be executed. Allow the government to seize and control communication media, all the smartphones. Allows the government to take over all electric power, gas, petroleum, fuels and minerals. Does the Bible tell you to prevent you from buying and selling? Allows the government to seize all means of transportation, including personal cars, trucks, vehicles of any kind, and total control all of our highways, seaports and waterways. Allows the government to take over all food resources and farms. Allows the government to mobilize civilians into war brigades under government supervision. Allows the government to take over all health, education and welfare functions. Designates the Postmaster General to operate a national registration of all persons. Allows the government to take over all airports and aircraft, including commercial aircraft. Allows the Housing and Finance Authority to relocate communities, build new housing and public funds, designate areas to be abandoned, and establish new locations for populations. People are buying properties, I don't know why. Allow the government to take over railroads, inland waterways, public storage facilities. Specifies the responsibility of the Office of Emergency Planning and gives authorization to put all executive orders into effect in times of increased international tensions, economic or financial crisis. Does the Bible tell them you financial crisis, political crisis, religious crisis? That's the process. It's going to happen soon. Grants authority to Department of Justice to enforce the plans set out in executive orders, to institute industrial support, establish judicial and legislative liaison, to control all areas, to operate penal and correctional institutions, and to advise and assist the president. You know, they did a trial of martial law in a city. They gave instruction in 2013 in Boston. They told today, on this day, everybody stay indoors. The whole city was paralyzed for 24 hours. No one came out of any building. And it worked. They experiment what they want to do and see it's how effectively it works. And they have everything set. The stage is set. One morning, we will rise up with a shock. Are we ready? It is not what my intention to doubt that the doctrines of the Illuminati and principles of Jacobism had not spread in the United States. On the contrary, on one is more truly satisfied on this fact than I am. This is George Washington when he was president. The new world order in your pocket. Obviously, you don't have dollars, so it's not in your pocket. But Americans, I have it in my pocket. I carry a dollar in my pocket. Not for its value, but for its value to talk about. The group Illuminati and America were conceived side by side, 2 months apart, in 1776. And Illuminati is working very well. This is an institute outside the Rockefeller Plaza. You know Rockefeller is a bank? Anybody knows this? Rockefeller is a private, family-owned bank. This bank and there's another bank. Anybody knows another private bank that is relevant for us as Seventh-day Adventist last day generation to understand economic crisis? Pardon? Name of the bank, New World Order Elite People, Rothschild's Bank. Rockefeller's Bank, Rothschild's Bank control the finances of the world. They hold money, you have a financial crisis. And they can do it whenever they want, anytime they want. You see this one? This is a honor medal they give to the gallant officers of the military, army, navy in the United States. This is a gallantry award. But look at that. Just remember that and look at the next one. Straight from the seat, the devil. You see people doing this? Oh, what happened? Some of my pictures disappeared. But anyway, you know the names. Names are put up there. Can you see this? And this is what they do in a church, Satan's church service. You have to do both your hands to owe allegiance to him. And anybody who has owed their allegiance to him have to publicly do this every time. Every time. You see Christian preachers doing it. You see your rock stars doing it. I didn't put your rock stars. All rock stars do it. All your musicians do it. Put out in the world. All your movie stars do it. Put out in the world. Can you see this? Look at this. September 11th. Thanks. These are playing cards. These are playing cards produced in 1995. When did September 11th happen? Which year? 2001. In 1995, we have these playing cards. That's the Pentagon, that's the Twin Towers. You know what's happening behind the scenes? I'll show you something else. This is Vatican City. This is yet to happen. It's happening now as we speak. Peaceful, conservative church nation. This is another card. I highlighted this just to show you. London 2010. It was also part of the cards. Produced in 1995. If you fold a $20 bill like this, you will see that's a real picture of Pentagon in flames. You turn that $20 bill to the other side, you can see the left side is lower and the right side is higher. So precisely planned and executed. On a $50 bill, encrypted images for a nuclear strike. Don't know when this will happen or if it will happen. If God allows it to happen, it will happen. These are the New World Order people. Look at the pictures. Chief Justice, he's not wrong anymore, he's retired. He said this, the real rulers in Washington are invisible and exercise power from behind the scenes. This is the Supreme Court. On Wednesday, June 26, 2013, the U.S. Supreme Court delivered a landmark victory for gay rights by forcing the federal government to recognize same-sex marriages. But if you look on top of the Supreme Court, that's Moses holding the Ten Commandments. And what's happening underneath the Ten Commandments? When the current Pope came into office, he was eager. He's a man born of quick things to be done. He could not wait for the date of the meeting in Assisi, which happens in October. He could wait even one month. In September, he calls everybody to the Vatican itself. All religious leaders. I ask, what do they have to do with the Pope? What is the first beast going to do, along with the second beast? Remember, I put this slide only to remind us of the Holocaust. Look at some of Christian authors saying Billy Graham. I won't read all of them for want of time. Billy Graham, Robert Schiller, Paul Crutch, all that. They say, there's no room for neutrality. You have to take sides. Are you taking sides? Look at this EU Parliament building in Strasbourg. By the grace of God, I stood in front of it and took the picture. For my memory's sake. Remember this? This picture, this is from a magazine, photo from a magazine. Europe, many times one voice. What does that represent? Tower of Babel. Look at this. Are there similarities? We have a modern structure today. Are there similarities? That building stands in Flansburg, France. You can go and look if you want. I've seen it. Heard of this? Have you heard of this, Chrysler? You haven't heard of it? The building, the proposal is to build, make one building in the city of Berlin, in the heart of Berlin. The site is there ready. They're waiting for funds. You know what the funds are meant to be? People have to give funds. That's the plan. Everybody's urged to give at least 10 euros towards this project. This is a three-quadrant building proposal. One, there's a central community area, and they have three separate areas. One for one for Jews, one for Christians, and one for Muslims. The three monotheistic religions in the world. So they can worship separately and mingle together in the common area. When everything, when all the ice is broken together, when all have commonality, they separate the partitions. They all worship together. That's the plan. How soon it's going to take place? Will it take place? We don't know. But the plan exists. Purpose-driven church. Rick Warren, how many of us know him? And he's invited to speak in our institutions. You know what he teaches? Go find out. First time in the history of papacy in Vatican City, you have Islamic prayers being offered. This is like we call doxology, it's an excellent. Look at the meaning of it, it's sung in Latin during Easter. Specifically during Easter only. Look at the meaning of the word sung in Latin. Flaming Lucifer finds mankind. I say, O Lucifer, who will never be defeated? Christ is your son who came back from hell. Shed his peaceful light and is alive and reigns in the world without end. That's the doxology, like what we call it, at Easter Mass. Somebody will come up and sing. One person comes and sings. Anybody knows that person? He was a former Jesuit priest. His name is Dr. Malachi Martin. Heard of the name?
Yes.
This is his statement. Those who are under 70 will see at least the basic structures of the new world government installed. Those who are under 40 will surely live under its legislative, executive, and judiciary authority and control. Speak about this new world order not as something about a distant corner of time, but as something that is imminent. An insider who has been touched by the Holy Spirit came out to tell us what is happening inside. God doesn't leave his people without information and knowledge. My people perish for lack of knowledge. God also says, where there is no vision, what happens?
Perish.
But as in the days of Noah, so shall it be when the coming of the Son of Man be. Lot of people think these are the people in the world, but this philosophy that existed in the days of Noah is also present today in the remnant church. Look at the attributes of as the people, because Matthew 24 is the signs that Jesus gave. Jesus repeated the signs in Matthew 24, Mark 13, and Luke 21, three times. When God says once, it's important. When God says twice, it is extremely important. When it's third time, meaning it's a matter of life and death, eternal life and death I'm talking about.
Oh, bless the great God I've never heard of.
Denounce Noah's preaching of the coming judgment. Today, people don't want to hear about judgment. As we were coming, Rajiv and Trasu were sharing about their experience and what I had in my room. They were having study with somebody and the person said, "Don't talk about judgment. Love, mercy and grace. Love, mercy and grace will exhaust if you don't receive it. Widespread moral perversion. Do we see? I want us to examine ourselves. Don't look at people out there. Examine ourselves. Widespread moral perversion. Do we have that in our lives? Satanic activity. Misguided by leaders. Lot of people go to church, listen to what is preached. That is gospel truth. Sorry, don't take what I'm saying here, gospel truth. Go and examine it. From the word of God and the testimony of Jesus Christ, which is a pen of inspiration written by Ellen White. Reject God's authority. Did not believe the earth could be completely destroyed by water. They believed that they knew it and understood it all, like all of us. I thought that for all my childhood, because we have been taught everything since childhood. Just examine. Wednesday prayer meeting, Friday Wednesday prayer meeting, Sabbath day. That's three times a week. As a church, family of God. Times 52. Times I'm 55. I know it all, don't I? I know nothing. Until we come to that realization, we know nothing. God will not reveal it to us. Shakespeare wrote, "There is a line unseen by us that crosses every path, the hidden boundary between God's patience and His wrath." You see the changes coming through. Today you open any calendar, even on your phones especially, which is the first day of the week. So when you ask a child today is going to school, which is the first day of the week? So obviously what becomes the seventh day of the week? Can you see the program? This is the first law, Sunday law, that ever came to planet Earth. By Emperor Constantine, 7th March, AD 321. For want of time, I'm going to pass. And then we have more laws coming too. Today, I want to show you Sunday law is almost there in almost every country in the world, in small bits and pieces, programming people's minds. Because if you pass a Sunday national law worldwide at one time, there will be revolution. You think people are going to accept it? No, you have to be programmed so that you're ready to receive it when it comes into force, full time. US, Israel, Greece, Argentina, Europe, France, Netherlands, UK, India, atheists, churches, Argentina, Polish, Angolans, Belgium, Italy, Switzerland, Austria, New Zealand, Nigeria, Singapore, Germany, Portugal, Dominican Republic, Fiji, Ireland. I just put a few, because there are thousands of countries, not thousands of countries, but hundreds of countries. Pope Benedict admits the 7 day Saturday is a true Bible Sabbath. He made a public statement March 2011. Testimonies for the Churches, Volume 5, page 72 says, "As Jesus views the state of his professed followers today, he sees base ingratitude, hollow formalism, hypocritical insincerity, pharisaical pride, and apostasy." That's the beginning of us. What must I do? So you've seen all of this. What must I do to have eternal life? The rich young ruler came and asked Jesus, and we should ask that question ourselves. And I ask this question. I ask God this question sincerely. What must I do to have eternal life? And the Lord will be the Lord things in my life. And I'll tell you the first step First step, mark my words. First step, I've said it 3 times. That we need to do is what we're going to look at. The rest will be individual. A story. It's a Bible story. It's a children's story. Children's story? Children's story. Everybody is children. Of their parents on earth, and of the Father in heaven. So it's a children's story for everyone, including me. I'm a child of God. Taken into captive, children of Israel were taken into captive. We begin in Daniel chapter 1. If you don't understand Daniel chapter 1 and apply it in our lives, Daniel chapter 2 is history anyway. That will remain to be a history. And 3 onwards, it's going to be serious for us. And Daniel proposed in his heart that he would not defile himself with the portion of his king's meat. We pick on verse 12, it says, prove thy servants, I beseech thee, 10 days, and let them give us pulse to eat and water to drink. And verse 15 says, at the end of 10 days, their countenance appeared fairer and fatter in flesh than all the children which did eat of the portion of the king's meat. Yeah. 10 days, fairer, fatter. I mean, not putting on weight, even 6-pack. John, 3 John. Verse 2 says, beloved, I wish above all things that thou mayest prosper and be healthy, even as this world prospered. John 10:10 says, I come that they might have life, and that they might have it more abundantly. Unfortunately, most of us are sick, including me. I'm recovered. You know, I had a disease. The Spirit of the Lord makes me tell this. I had a disease. Everybody listen carefully. This is my personal testimony. I had a disease. And the disease is called AIDS. I had AIDS. I want it to sink in your minds. I'll ask a question, nobody raise their hands. Answer it in your minds. Anybody here have AIDS? Don't raise your hands. If you think yes, or if you think no, I'll let you know why. Let me tell you again, listen carefully. I don't want you to go and propagate. The preacher came today and he said, yeah, AIDS. Let me listen carefully. I'm saying I did not have AIDS from HIV. I'll say that again. I did not have AIDS from HIV. I'll say it a 3rd time. I did not have AIDS from HIV. I have AIDS, which I use as an acronym to shake and wake people up. A for Adventist, I for in, D for deep, S for sleep. I had it. Adventist in deep sleep. The Lord has woken me up, and I'm recommending. Now you can examine whether you have AIDS or not. Have you woken up? God promised the children of Israel that if they would serve and obey Him, He would remove all sickness from them. Did He keep His promise? Did He keep His promise? It is there. It is there in Psalms. I didn't put the answer there because that's homework. Go and find out, did He keep His promise? It's in Psalms, I gave you a clue. What did God give children of Israel? Let me say this before I pass this. My time is finished, frankly speaking. I just looked at the clock. Will you give me grace? God's grace is so abundantly available for me to receive. Praise the Lord. Any objections? We have to take voting. I'm an elder in the church, this is what we have to do. take permission from people, unfortunately, for people to hear God's word. What a situation we live in, I tell you. So I have to give a testimony. Since you gave me grace, I have to give a testimony about God's grace. On one of these tours that the Lord sent me, my son turned 18, and I told him, son, what do you want for your 18th birthday? And in my heart, listen to this, in my heart, I didn't want to do the party. In my heart. But I don't want to tell him I don't want to do the party. You understand? A teenager won't take it well. So I said, son, what do you want me to do? See how God works. My son said to me, Dad, I don't want a party. I didn't say to him loud, but in my heart I said, praise the Lord. God is answering my desires. Now I went back and I said, okay, then think about what you want to do. I went back and I said, Lord, you answered my desire. I need to reward my son. The Bible tells me you reward your son with servants. No. My father rewards me so amazingly. So when I say Father, my heavenly Father, I want to reward my son that he'll never forget. I prayed and asked the Lord, what should I do? The Lord said, okay, just take him on a trip. I didn't realize that is also part of the fulfillment of my desire. Last year, four of us, halfway around the world, I asked my son, I'm impressed to take you somewhere, where do you want to go? He said, I want to go to Shanghai. And I think my wife said she wanted to go to Tokyo. And my son also said, I want to go to Tokyo. I asked my daughter, what did she want to say? She said she wants to go to New Zealand. And my wife also, my wife has always known this. Sorry, I'm open sincere. Sometimes I cut it short. This is reality. God is a witness and testimony. I'm very serious, I'm very plain, I'm very simple. And then I said, then she also said, I want to go to Bangkok. My cousins are here. I said, okay, all of you said something. What about me? In fact, I forgot to mention, I said to my son, son, I'll take you to Australia. Because you're back. So Australia was already on the cards. I said to my son, I want to take you to Australia because I have a friend in Australia. Actually, New Zealand. I thought Australia and New Zealand is where we go. This friend worked with me in Saudi Arabia for 10 years. 7 years, sorry, he left before me. And I was feeling guilty, very close friend of mine. We are still in touch. And I was feeling guilty. I did not tell him the Sabbath too. He's a Christian. I didn't tell him the Sabbath. I was feeling guilty all these years. I said, Lord, I need to go and tell you on the Sabbath. So I said, I'll take my son to Australia. And then New Zealand to Australia, close by, so we can visit. But my son said, Tokyo and Shanghai. My wife said, Tokyo and Bangkok. And what else is New Zealand in your part of the state? I said, I also want to see another place. I want to go to Malaysia. So I sat down looking at four of us going all this trip. Who am I to say no to my desires of my family? We looked at this. By the grace of God, I got all of this in less than 6,000 pounds. Can you believe it? After we made the trip and came back, I was looking, I didn't find nothing less than 12,000, 15,000 pounds. The same trip. Because God knows where this guy goes, the word of God is going to go. Because I not only plan trip, I plan to do God's word. My box will be full. I don't need too many clothes. I wash and wear my clothes. 3-4 pairs is enough. The rest is books. My luggage is full of books. Let me cut the story short. Every place we went, the word of God has been spread. I went to my friend's house, let me tell you. I am planning such a way. We're going to do Bible study with him. And this is meant to be holiday for my family. I do Bible study with family. We're on the flight. Anybody sit next to me? Bible study. Any flight? Anywhere I go. By the grace of God. Went to my family's, my friend's home. He planned in such a way that we arrive on Friday. So he lives in Brisbane, take us around Brisbane. And he said, he'll take you to Gold Coast, morning Brisbane, afternoon Gold Coast. I said to him, 5:30, I want to be in your house. I want to show him Sabbath keeping. Show Sabbath keeping. So we landed there. He took us around 5:30. Before 5:30, we arrived in his house. Met his wife, kids, and their mother was there. You know each other very well, so they were excited to see me after so many years. We chatted for half an hour or so. They said, okay, 7 o'clock, we'll have dinner. I said, fine. After dinner, we'll do a small study in the book of Revelation. My friend got excited, jumped up from his sofa, and he said, oh, I'll call my friends. I thought he was going to say no. He got on the mobile phone, and in no time, in half an hour, by the time we finished our food, 8 families arrived. Vesper service now in the house. 8 o'clock we started, we sang 2 songs, 8:15. I go with my tools everywhere I go. When I say tools, memory sticks and clickers and everything else are always with me. 8:15 I stood up. 10:30 I said, shall we stop? In fact, 9:30 I said, let us stop. Every half an hour asking, shall we stop? They said, no brother, continue. 12 o'clock, no brother, continue. 12:30, I said, you have to go home and I stopped. And after everybody left, my friend and his wife continued. He gave 1:30. 6 o'clock, we have to catch a flight from Brisbane to Sydney. It was 7 o'clock, I think. Can't remember the time. 1 hour before departure, we wake up. The devil did not let us get up. My mobile phone, which is so faithful all the time, which wakes me up when I need it, didn't go off, or it went off and it wakes up. 1 hour before departure, my friend comes and says, are you ready? That's when we wake up. I can give testimonies just for forever, it will take forever. I'm trying to say, people out of this Seventh-day Adventist Church are willing, eager, listening, God's truth. Opposite end. But Seventh Adventist, it's taken more than 30 minutes. Oh, 1 hour has passed. Why is he still yapping? So I have to say a few more testimonies only for encouragement. The Lord is asking me to say this. It's not my plan. The Lord put this year on my heart. He's called me to India. Because when I came into this country, before I came, the Lord, I prayed, Lord, I want to serve you here and in India. I don't know how that will happen. So the Lord now opened the path for me. They called me to India now to train pastors. Train pastors? Who, me? This is what I said. Train pastors, me? Do you know I'm not a pastor? Everybody knows a pastor. Everybody knows me. Do you know I didn't go to Spice or study theology? Yeah, we know you didn't study theology. But the Lord impressed to call you. Of all the people on planet Earth, me to go and train pastors. Down person like me. But God knows I'm a willing body to stand up. Just a body to stand up. That's what he needs. He needs a living body to stand up. He will speak. And I'm that body. And I recommend that body to all of you. I'm telling you, I went in May this year, hot. I went from single digits to 40 plus degrees. The nearest fan where I'm standing is one fan there and one fan here, nothing on my head. I'm wearing a tie. Of course, no, I didn't wear a blazer because it's So what? From 8:30 till 8 o'clock. 8 hours I'm standing. 8 hours. 4 days in a row. Not a single day away from speaking God's word. Not a single day. Monday to Thursday with pastors. Always more than 150 pastors. I did two sections. In India we call sections. Here you understand them as conferences. Two conferences. That makes sense to you. 150 plus pastors. 4 days. 8 hours. They didn't call anybody else. I did two sections. The Lord impressed me. Weekends. Target. Churches. Friday evening, I speak. Let me give you my last trip example. Friday evening and I spoke in Bombay, Mumbai. Morning I took a flight. Saturday I spoke in Hyderabad City Church. Saturday afternoon I went to speak with a family who is not attending church in Hyderabad City. Sunday I went to speak with my uncle and his children who are all Catholics. I said to them, I'm coming. They said, you come and see us on Sunday. I said, no, I don't have time. He said, no, 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 you must come and see us. I said, I will come and see you if you give me time to talk to you. Ask any child to give it. Full measure. They said, okay, you come. Bible study in India. There are so many testimonies in that Bible study. Time went off like this. The bus I'm supposed to catch from, those of you from Andhra will know, right back to Vijayawada bus, passes through Manastalipuram, my uncle's house is in Manastalipuram. It takes 10 minutes from his house to get to the main road to catch the bus. 4 o'clock is my ticket booked to catch the bus in the afternoon. I'm there, my uncle took 1.5 hours to do his teaching and he gave me time now. I hardly have 10 minutes. In 10 minutes I can't finish the 3 minutes message. This technology is so good, the driver has a number, you have the driver's number, the driver called to say, I'm starting now, I'll be there in 5 minutes. My cousin says, time to go. I said, no, I didn't finish. Then 4 o'clock came up and the driver called, where are you? My cousin says, the driver is there. No, he wait for me and I didn't finish. 4:10, every minute he says, I said, no, no, I didn't finish. 4:10, 4:15, I didn't finish. 4:15, finally, by the grace of God, the Lord impressed me, time to go now. By the time the message finished, my cousins thought, okay, we are simply going to make a waste of trip over there and come back. Bus will be gone. I said, no, let's go. Bus is waiting for me. I know nothing from where these words are coming. These words are being uttered from my mouth as a testimony for my Catholic cousins. 4:23, we arrived there at the bus stop. The bus is waiting. Almost 25 minutes. They said, this never happens. I said, yes, it doesn't happen. But it will happen for God's servants. When I go on my next trip, I'm going to talk to them again. So I have to give a full testimony of this trip. So that you are impressed that a dumb person like me can do these things by the grace of God. Those of you from Hyderabad or Andhra will know Satish Kumar, television speaker, Calvary Temple. Those of you who don't know, Google it. Calvary Temple. Its membership is 200,000 members. They meet 5 times a day, 35,000 seating hall, which this man built in 52 days like Nehemiah. The Lord impressed me, made contact with him. He said, hey, Mr. Speaker, who am I? I don't know nothing. What will I talk to you? I made contents. And the Lord made the contents. I went to his place and I wanted to address Sabbath with him. That's what the Lord impressed me. The Lord said, no, he will talk to you. I said, go and teach my seminary students. He has 100 seminary students in Calvary Temple in Hyderabad. I went there. I wanted to do a presentation like last night. It didn't work. I said, Lord, now you have to speak. I stood up by the grace of God. Those people were excited, those students. Sir, when are you coming again? I said, God willing, we'll come again. And that is monitored by CCTV by Satish Kumar. And he told my contact, next time he comes, I'll make him speak in my church. I'm a body available for God to use. On another Sunday, the Lord impressed me Sundays, go to Sunday churches. On another Sunday, same city, Hyderabad, I went to. Another group of Sunday churches. Morning I spoke in one Sunday church, at night I spoke in another Sunday church. And the group of this leader's Sunday church, he said to me, brother, give me notice, 2 months notice. Next time, tell me when you're coming, give me 2 months notice. And give me 1 week. I will hold public meetings and you will speak. You know, in Sunday church meeting, people hold public meeting. How many people come? The harvest is plenty, reapers are few. Reapers are sitting here, sleeping. In everybody's churches, around the world. I'm not talking about you, I'm talking about everybody. And we think we are going to heaven. No, I came to tell you no. We are going straight to heaven, the way we are. God's grace is so abundant, but conditions apply to receive the grace. Can I continue? Will you give me grace? Spiritual food is better than physical food. Physical food will put you to sleep. Spiritual food will make you awake. Something happened with the children of Israel. 11 years journey from promised land. Everybody knows this story. I'm not going to read all of it. I'll tell you the gist of it. Everybody knows this story. 11 days journey from the promised land. Children of Israel ask for something. What do they ask? Flesh fools of Egypt. I pass some of these readings. Why is our health so important to God? Before I say that, let me say, how many children of Israel left Egypt? The Bible says, Bible gives a number. Bible gives a number. Homework. I can tell you my homework. Because I want you to go and study and see if what I'm saying is true or wrong. It's a very large number. And that's talking about men. What about women and the children? And how many answer? I'll give you the number so that you at least can get some insight to it. 650,000 men. Of these people who left Egypt, how many entered Canaan? You know what the cause is? You know what the cause is? Go and examine it in the Word of God. 6:19 and 20 says that your body is the temple of the Holy Ghost, therefore glorify God in your body. If you look at the design of the sanctuary, thy way, O Lord, is in the sanctuary. Psalms 77:13 says, if you look at the picture of the sanctuary, it's amazing. Lord, we still today are living in the outer court. We are not following Jesus. Thy way, O Lord, is in the sanctuary. Follow Jesus through the sanctuary. He has moved from earth after the sacrifice to the holy place. And from the holy place, October 22, 1844, he moves into the most holy place. And we are not following him. We know about it. The devil knows better than us. He has no hope. We have. We are not following Jesus Christ.
Even physically, his body is moving from one place to another. We are not moving physically nor spiritually.
You know the root word for salvation is sozo. You know the meaning of sozo? Health. What is a good Bible rule for healthy living? 1 Corinthians 10:31 says, whether therefore you eat or drink or whatsoever you do, do it all to the glory of God. That means everything. What will God do to those who define their bodies? It's all there for us to know. In the Word of God, 1 Corinthians 3:16 and 17, ye are the temple of God. If any man define the temple of God, him shall God destroy. Mercy, justice, love, peace. No judgment. You know that song that we sing? Rock of Ages clap for you. By the grace of God, most of the songs, I don't look at hymnal anymore. Because it's going to be in your heart. Very soon we can't be congregating like this and worshiping. If you don't have it in your heart, you can't sing. You can't praise God. You don't know Bible verses. You can't identify and strengthen yourself. Memorize things now in this day and age. Last of the eye, taste of the food. We are coming to the root cross of the problem and the first step that every single remnant child of God has to make. Mark the word as it has to be. But it's a choice. I mark the word again and say it's a choice that you have to make. What do you want to do? Psalms 90:10 says, the days of your years, 70 years of pain. Is that what God said in the Garden of Eden? Is that what God said in the Garden of Eden? Look at the time, how people lived before the flood. And look at the ages after the flood. It's all from the Bible. One question I'll ask, if anybody knows the answer, tell it. If you don't know the answer, I'll tell you what we do. Why did the age, lifespan come down? Sangeet says, meet it. Everybody agrees with that? Any opposition? I have to be fair. You know why God gave meat eating? It's written in the spirit of cross. To reduce the age of human beings. Sorry, that's the down reality. That's a graph to tell you age over the years. Jesus' first temptation. We saw man's first temptation in the Garden of Eden. Jesus' first temptation on earth. Galatians 6:7 says, be not deceived, God is not mocked. Whatsoever therefore a man soweth, such so also shall he reap. Anybody knows about this? Myelin. All nurses, medical people should know this. What is it? Quickly. It's the sheath around? Pardon? Yeah? Nerve cells. Yeah? You know the effects of it? The fat that goes in through our mouths goes and deposits around the cells, including other cells in the body. But the cause and effect of this cell determines a lot of things that are effective for us today, especially as remnant. What does it do? The fats deposited around the sheath impairs the transistors. Transitions, depending on the amount of the deposit of the fat around this. These are the impulses. That is why our brain cells are not giving the right signals for the body to function, plus our moral judgments. If you have any of the symptoms, I gave you symptoms of Laodicea last night. I'm giving you physical symptoms now. Physical symptoms, if you have any of these symptoms, you have to unclog your arteries. I gave you a remedy for that already this morning. Look at the symptoms. If you have these physical symptoms, one of the cause would be fat around the myelin. This is science. What is a good health? Christian rule. Every man that striveth for the mastery is temperate in all things. Are the Bible health principles still practical today? Proverbs 23:2. Some people eat to live. Some people live to eat. Okinawans are the longest living people. Also normal in the before, not now. This is history for 1720s. Were the longest living people because they were vegetarians. Chicken farming techniques, you want to look at this. Arsenic is added in chicken feed, bone meal, and everything else is added in chemicals today. What would it take a normal chicken to grow 3.5 grams, 1.5 kilo in 6 weeks? Today you need only 3.5 kg of feed. 17 grams of feed is to reach that mass. You have sick chickens that are coming out. Let me show you some pictures. I think I have some pictures. There it is. This is how chickens are grown. Four, the plates. All the chain supermarkets that we have, this is how they grow them. Because the turnaround has to be quick. They have to grow them quick. Otherwise, well, there will be a day that you won't have any meat there in the supermarket because you didn't have enough production. It has to be produced quick. They should have been growing like this, ideally at least, or out in the country. And those feed, you know what they do with them? This contaminated meat and bone meal is now put as food for animals. And that has come through even the milk. So there's not a detail. I'll leave the presentation for you for a detailed study if you want. This is what is produced in the milk. Cannibalistic activities are happening even among the chickens and the animals. If you read in detail, from what has happened in the past, all of these bacteria, you know, those are in the assistant doctors work in the hospital. The causes and root cause, from where do they come? Where do they come from? Find out. These are all ready for the plate. Through the supermarket chains. They should be ideally out like that. These are ready for the supermarket chains. What about fish industry? Some people say Jesus ate fish. So we can eat fish. Did you eat fish in heaven? Jesus was in the outer court on earth. He went to the holy place, and now in the most holy place. Look at the articles in the place. Sacrifice is finished. Once the sacrifice was made, God instituted the priest to eat of the sacrifice. And now Jesus is instituted to eat of his sacrifice. That is why we have communion, not meat eating. Understand, because we don't want to study the sanctuary. And the psalmist says, "Thy way, Lord, in the sanctuary." We know this by heart. We quote it, but we don't know what it means. Genealogy of human diet. This is the genealogy of human diet from the Word of God. Original diet. These are the Bible texts. You can find them if you want. Vegetable enters human diet after sin. Genetically modified foods, yeah, even vegetables are the biggest problem we face. That is why the scripture prompts admonishes us to grow our own and eat. That's why you admonish us in the last days to move out into the countryside so that you have your own ground to grow your own plants. And live off your own produce. That's the advice. We don't want to even know about it, we don't want to make any measures about it. Coffee and tea, everybody drinks. Lot of celebrants drink coffee and tea. You don't have to raise your hand to you. If you are one of them, the spirit of prophecy, you know what it says? It is sin. Clearly identifies drinking tea and coffee is sin. Close in a minute. Vegetarians have more endurance You know the biggest animal that is existing today? Elephant.
Can run at 25 miles per hour for 10 to 12 hours continuously without stopping. Tigers and cheetahs and all the lions, they can run fast, but
in no time they're panting in less than 10 minutes. God wants people who can endure. We finish back to the original diet. To go to the original diet of not eating meat, we have to prepare our tastes, our likes, and our wants on earth. And we are living in this last day. Original health message, few quotes and I close. Interestingly, Mahatma Gandhi wrote this. Sorry, I did say two statements of Mahatma Gandhi. One statement is this. Mahatma Gandhi writes, eating of flesh is not reasonable of any condition. In my viewpoint, eating flesh is not the appropriate diet for mankind. Human beings are far better than the animals. It is not worthwhile to take the flesh like the lower class and become the greater of them. We need to make a firm stand. Some of the quotes are there as I close to sit down. Some of the quotes say, in the last days, people will continue. She's talking to the remnant. Let me make this clear. She's talking to the remnant church, Seventh-day Adventist. In the last days, people who continue to subsist on meat eating, more light will not be given to them. She also says, it is like sinning. We don't do God's work. I'm telling about me, my experience. As long as I was eating that meat, I had nothing to do about being a witness and about talking about God. Once I gave it up, nobody, no way, nobody, no way, I'm telling you, spares hearing the word of God who comes in my proximity. Nobody. Even yesterday, let me tell you this and sit down. Even yesterday, we finished, we installed this. Even yesterday, one of my colleagues came and talked to me about this Donald Trump and Israel and all of this. Anybody says anything, you give me an inch, I'll pounce on it. I gave explanation and I took them to the Bible. You know what is going to happen? This person is going to come next weekend. I'm doing this again in Harvard Church. This person is going to come with her 17-year-old son. This is an indigenous white person with a 17-year-old child, Friday night, next week in Harvard. We are asleep. God made us up.